The next speaker is Dr. Natasha Rahman. Natasha has been with us since 2011. Yes. Of course, Natasha did her search path and cytology fellowship at MSK. She is a search path at Hopkins and cytology here. Okay. I keep thinking you've been here for a long time. She's in the thoracic team. Natasha has done a lot of work on really detailing many of the tumors in the lung cancer field. She's also an author of the Quick Reference Guide to Immunohistochemistry. Many of you may have heard that book. And she is a great Twitter, putting cases out on, and good cases. And she gives actually good feedback for people who actually answer back. So even though I don't do Twitter, I do watch people who Twitter. So I'll let Natasha talk about a case.
Thank you so much, Meera. It's really great to be here to present. It's so nice to always see our alumni coming back. Look forward to saying hello to whoever I haven't had a chance to say hi yet. So let's look at case number 5. Oops, what happened? Sorry about that. Oh. Not sure what's happening. Doesn't, when I scroll, it doesn't let me advance. It's weird. Sorry about that. Well, I can advance. Well, we can do that. So this is a case of a 37-year-old man who is a heavy smoker. He has smoked one pack per day, starting when he was just 17. And he presented with chest and shoulder pain and a neck mass. And you can see here, this is his CT scan. And it shows a large mass, 12 centimeters, involving lung and mediastinal structures, invading chest wall, involving the pleura. You see massive neck lymphadenopathy. Oops. Doesn't advance. Oh, okay. Okay, thank you so much. Okay, we're all set. So this is another imaging. This is something called dual energy CT that was taken just a few weeks after the patient's initial presentation. And you can see even here the massive expansion of this tumor, which now fills the entire hemithorax. And you can see invasion over the vertebral body. So just getting one step ahead, I wanted to share with you my email exchange with one of the oncologists taking care of this patient, sort of just to give you a little more personal sense of the presentation for this patient. So, and I'll just read it to you. So this 37-year-old patient of mine has one of the most aggressive tumors I've ever seen, literally a monster exploding inside of him. He was simulated for radiation therapy for mild canal stenosis, but the next day, his legs couldn't move due to full cord compression. Also within a day, a small supraclavicular lymph node also exploded into a massive monster poking out of his neck. We're going to put up a good fight for him. So I just wanted to share it with you. It was I got a permission to share it, but it sort of gives you I think some a bit of a personal sense of how these tumors can present. And I also wanted to, a lot of the staff here and former alumni know that this is one of the greatest, I think, strength of Memorial, that we have this relationship with our clinicians, and we can learn from each other, and we can learn the clinical side, and we can teach them about pathology, which was the case in this case. So let's look at pathology. So this was a surgical biopsy from the neck mass that you can see here. Shows this pink tumor with islands of tumor cells surrounded by geographic necrosis. Kind of at medium power, you see pink cells that are loosely cohesive, extremely high mitotic rate. And you can see kind of jumping out at you immediately very prominent nucleoli and kind of this overall monomorphic look. So let's zoom in a little closer. And nothing may jump out at first, but as you keep staring, you will see kind of these cells with a kind of plasmacytoid shape and kind of indented nuclei. And this look kind of can resemble signet ring cells or cells of hallmark cells of anaplastic large cell lymphoma. And of course, this brings to mind the rhabdoid-like look. Some fields had very discohesive look, as shown here. When you take pictures of this tumor, it looks like you're taking pictures of a cytology smear. So this is a higher power look again, these cells. So this is a differential. So again, 37-year-old man, very heavy smoker, large undifferentiated thoracic tumor. So this presentation together with this morphology is very, very suggestive of a diagnosis. And something that, if you're aware of it, you can confirm with very limited panel of stains. But otherwise, you will have a very wide differential, which I included here, anaplastic lymphoma, could it be some germ cell tumor, not carcinoma, melanoma, so a variety of things come to mind. So by immunostains, if you worked it up for all these entities, this is largely what you would get. And this is actually an example of keratin. Keratin tends to be completely negative, but can be focally positive. Usually, with this whole negative profile, the most consistently positive stain is vimentin, which, of course, we know tells us that the tumor is immunoviable. And the drum roll, of course, those of you who, even without seeing the case, knew that I was presenting an interesting case, knew I would present this. So this is the this is what cinches the diagnosis. This is a stain for SMARCA4 or BRG1, which shows a loss in tumor cells with retained staining in stromal and lymphoid normal cells, and or concurrent loss of another member of switch SNF family, SMARCA2, also known as BRM1, also a similar loss. So the diagnosis, this is something that currently in the literature known as SMARCA4 deficient thoracic sarcoma. And this is, as recent fellows and current staff know, this is something that our group has been collecting and working on for several years. And we now have a paper that we just a few days ago resubmitted with revisions to Journal of Thoracic Oncology, where, as I will show you, we are showing evidence that these are not sarcomas, but these are instead what can be thought of as dedifferentiated or undifferentiated carcinomas or tumors related to epithelial precursors. And we've gone through many, many, many emails and many discussions on the term. And this is the one we suggested, sarcomatoid tumor. But with sarcomatoid implying a very special phenotype. So this is undifferentiated round cell rhabdoid morphology. So what I wanted to do in the next in the remainder of the talk is to give you an update about these tumors, particularly focusing on the diagnostic issues. And at the end, I will show you some of our evidence about the biological nature of these tumors. So just to start, let's do a brief background about SMARCs and switch SNF complex, which are the complicated names coming from yeast genetics, and I kind of gave you some translation on the bottom. I always have to look it up. So this complex is getting a lot of interest from biologists and oncologists because a recent large screen genomic studies finding that these are some of the most commonly mutated genes in tumors, bordering probably only P53. But what we all know as pathologists is that there are several tumor types that are almost pathogenetically associated with a specific components of this complex. And the prototypical example are pediatric malignant rhabdoid tumors that are associated in most cases with the loss of SMARCB1 or INI1, and in a minority of cases of SMARCA4 or BRG1. And more recently, the tumors called small cell carcinomas of the ovary hypercalcemic type, which are universally associated with the loss of SMARCA4. And I know this is super controversial topic for GYN pathologists, but because of some phenotypic features and these associations, it's been proposed that these tumors actually represent a type of ovarian malignant rhabdoid tumor. So, but other than these paratypical associations and several other tumors that very characteristically have loss of these components, another theme that has emerged recently is that for the loss of this component being being found in carcinomas of various organs that undergo dedifferentiation, so so-called dedifferentiated or undifferentiated carcinomas that frequently have rhabdoid, or as I'll show you, rhabdoid slash round cell features. And as I will show you, we think that this is these thoracic tumors are kind of a very special and extreme example of this last family. So the first description of these tumors was just in 2015 in a study from a French sarcoma group that was all followed by the studies, one from Japan, with the first author of Akihiko Yoshida, who was our illustrious memorial alumnus. He was actually Search Path Fellow at the time that I was a cytology fellow here. And the other main paper was from the Mayo Group with our own Jen Sauter as a lead author when she was a fellow there. And since then, there's been a number of other smaller series or case reports for a total of 65 cases. And our study included our initial experience with 22 cases. And since then, we recently updated our tally. We've seen probably close to 40 of these cases, which first tells you these are not rare. We see them probably... I would say at least maybe every month, sometimes every other month, so we see them regularly, although, of course, we see more because there, many of them are sent to Bill as consults, but they're much more common, let's say, than not carcinomas. Basically, I think this is something, and another thing, I think this, I think it's useful for everyone to know about because you can see it in metastatic setting, and because also this is sort of, I think, reflective of a general family of tumors, and I've discussed with many of my colleagues as they're seeing kind of analogous or trying to study analogous tumors in other organ systems. So let's look at the histology. So this is a spectrum of these tumors, and starting on the left, this is something that we can easily all appreciate is very rhabdoid. So this doesn't need any introduction to pathologists. We know we know rhabdoid morphology very well, kind of cytologically, but also know the distinctive feature of disc cohesion. That's a very kind of a hallmark of these tumors. But in thoracic tumors, they're almost never fully rhabdoid. It's usually a very focal feature. So most tumors look like exactly the example I showed you, where you kind of have to stare for a while to notice these kind of vaguely rhabdoid cells, or kind of here cells that are just have flattened nucleus, a little bit pushed to the side. So what is the hallmark of this of these tumors? And I think it's something that for me and for our group was definitely a learning curve to start to appreciate that morphology. And I, again, after thinking about it, I think a good term to capture it is round cell, meaning it's almost like rhabdoid cells, but they don't have inclusions. But you have all the other features. They are disc cohesive, they're a bit monomorphic with prominent nucleoli. This morphology is actually not surprising, given that looking at the literature on pediatric malignant rhabdoid tumors, they're not all rhabdoid. I mean, that's a hallmark cell, but they can be very focal, and some of them may not have them at all. That's kind of, I think round cell morphology is something we should appreciate as a spectrum of rhabdoid phenotype. And another very similar tumor is proximal epithelioid sarcoma. I hope Mira agrees with me. So I think these tumors look very similar. And something else we're learning to appreciate is a spectrum. So many of them are classic and disc cohesive, but there is some cohesion in some tumors. And even more problematic is some of them can get fairly pleomorphic. And this is such an example, but you can see that kind of hallmark morphology is there. But this is where we get into the problem of how do you separate them from carcinomas? Because in the lung, just conventional carcinomas can have SMARCA4 loss. And there are some distinguishing features. I'll just point out them to you on one of the slides. But I think this sort of brings back this issue, and I think this will be the question for us to solve you know, as the next frontier in these tumors. Like in some cases, where is the line that distinguishes these tumors from carcinomas? And can they be really kind of tumors on a continuum that are sort of a little bit of both? So I think we'll have to, but in the most cases, they really fall at the ends of the spectrum and can be readily separated. So few immunohistochemical chemical highlines. These tumors have very peculiar immunoprofile. And if you're not, if you don't know it and if you're not thinking about it, it can be very confusing. So they usually, as I showed you, negative will have low keratins, although if you do EMA, usually positive. They frequently have stem cell marker expression, so cell 4, CD34, they frequently have CD99. So if you think about it for a moment, like this presentation frequently in a young patient, keratin negative, some of these positive, these tumors are a pitfall central. These cases have been referred for consults to us with all sorts of differentials. Is this a vascular tumor? I know Mira had a consult sent to her. Is this a vascular tumor? Is it some kind of Fine angiosarcoma? Is this a Ewing sarcoma? Is this a germ cell tumor? Depending on the combination of stains. I will not have much time to go into the detail, but just to kind of get back to that question of distinguishing when is a SMARC deficient tumor carcinoma and when is it the sarcomatoid round cell rhabdoid tumor. And there are some very helpful markers. And these markers, Claudin-4 and SMARCA2, come from switch SNF sarcoma literature. These are the markers that come that are always deficient in malignant rhabdoid tumors. They're also consistently deficient in small cell hypercalcemics. And they're always, or virtually always, deficient in these thoracic tumors, kind of differentiating them from carcinomas. So overall, this is the message. This very distinctive immunoprofile, virtually negative or low keratin, stem cell marker expression, et cetera, is very similar to the phenotype of pediatric MRTs. And also, this is something that you may be more familiar with in the context of the differentiated and undifferentiated endometrial carcinomas, which I think in many ways are analogous to these tumors in the thorax. So something that I was thinking, this is the way I think about these tumors when we sign out and how I explain it to the fellows. So when should I think about it? So if you're looking at a tumor, and you have no idea what it is, you think you know it's malignant, but is it lymphoma, sarcoma, undifferentiated carcinoma, and stains are just not supporting anything, that's the time to think about it. And this is sort of another way to explain it. This is a very common way that these tumors come to us in consultation. So they look so distinctive, like I'll quote Bill, like it looks like it's a good example of something. So you know it's something, but you just cannot figure out what it is. So these tumors come to us with a kitchen sink of stains that were done. So this is a typical consult letter. This is one I counted 30 stains. It wasn't selected. I just grabbed the paperwork that I had on my desk. So if you're about to order stain number 31, that's time to think about this tumor. Just for a few minutes, this is a very kind of thoracic-specific issue, but clinical presentation of these patients is very distinctive. So much so that when you hear the presentation, 37 or young smoker with very large aggressive tumors, this is a clue. So this is a unique presentation among lung tumors in young patients. That's typically never smokers. They have EGFR, they have ALK. So this is really a unique tumor associated with young smokers. Why? I think that's also will be very interesting and important to sort out. What is the etiology? Why smoking in young patients? And they're extremely aggressive. With a median survival in our study and all studies across the publications of just a few months. And unfortunately, with our patient, even though our clinicians were able to temporize this explosive tumor for some time, the patient was unfortunately succumbed to disease just within 3 months from presentation. So in the remaining few minutes, I don't want to go spend too much time on this, but I'll show you some of the line of evidence why we are suggesting that these are not primary sarcomas, but in fact, within a family of these undifferentiated, dedifferentiated carcinomas. So the concept of sarcoma comes from this French sarcoma study, because in expression profiling, these tumors clusters with malignant rhabdoid tumors and small cell hypercalcemics. That's not surprising, because that's what their phenotype is. It's just that their origin is distinct. And there were clues in prior studies for them being different. First of all, the patients are all smokers. And both MRTs and SCOTs are genomically very simple tumors, where SMARCA4 or in some cases SMARCB1 is really either the sole or the dominant alteration. These tumors are very complex. They have multiple alterations, including consistent P53 and several other lines of evidence. And a few of these tumors have focal TTF1 and P40 expression. So already, even with data in prior studies, there were some clues that these are just not your usual sarcomas. So one piece of evidence that came from our study that wasn't available before is we found several composite tumors. So tumors that do have SMARCA4 loss, as shown here, but they have, in addition to this undifferentiated rhabdoid component, carcinomatous component, and it's best demonstrated by keratins or claudin. You can see this sharp drop. And here's another really nice example. This kind of myxoid undifferentiated areas, these tumors can be myxoid and SMARCA4 deficient, and you can see this drastic loss of keratin and claudin expression as you move from carcinomatous to undifferentiated histology. And we also did MSK impact NGS, which provided several lines of evidence linking these tumors to carcinomatous differentiation. So even the carcinomatous origin. So even though they're fully undifferentiated phenotypically, you can see evidence of smoking-associated non-small cell carcinoma type mutations, very high tumor mutation burden. For comparison, in malignant rhabdoid tumors, it's usually under 1. And I think the biggest smoking gun in these tumors was the presence of smoking signature. So genomic smoking signature has been like really a wonderful recent advance that is available that we can do with MSK impact and can be very useful for the tumor origin. For example, we've been able in some cases to confirm skin origin for tumors with UV signature. And the smoking signature is only seen in tumors of in carcinomas of lung and head and neck origin. So this really linked and all of these SMARC deficient sarcomatoid tumors have a smoking signature. And this, I think, provided very strong evidence linking them to carcinomatous differentiation. So the last question I will pose, does it matter? Did we answer an academic question in terms of the origin of these tumors? And it helps us know where in our categories to place these tumors. I do think it helps us histologically diagnose them because you can expect some spectrum of epithelial differentiation in some of them. But does it matter to the patient? And I think our answer is we don't know, but it may. In particular, there is a lot of interest in various therapeutic approaches to tumors with switch SNF alterations. And in particular, there is a lot of excitement in EZH2 inhibitors. It's the drugs that showed activity in malignant rhabdoid tumors with a patient a few years ago with a kid who showed complete response. And that's really unprecedented in such tumors. These thoracic tumors are included in the trials of these drugs, but will they be active there? Because these are, even though they have some phenotypic similarity, their genomic background is completely different. So let's stay tuned, but at least this could justify our better understanding of the different origin of these tumors. So in summary, this SMARCA4 deficient sarcomatoid tumors is a distinct, both clinically and pathologically, category for tumors that were previously unclassified or misclassified. And I really feel in our practice it's been probably the most significant advance in the last few years because, as I've shown you, these cases come to us with all sorts of differentials and incorrect considerations. And so it's really gratifying to be able to classify these tumors. And again, I'll quote Bill: when we diagnose these tumors, we feel like we're getting smarter. Again, they are uncommon, but they're not rare. And remember these unusual phenotypes that can really send you in the wrong directions. And then whenever, if you see this distinctive presentation in young smokers, think of these tumors. And again, treatment approaches remain to be determined. I wanted to thank so many collaborators who over several years helped move this study along and help with our evolution of thinking about them. I particularly wanted to thank our thoracic team, Bill, Darren, Jason, Jen. It was really a wonderful journey to really start from having no idea what these tumors are from the initial papers to really starting to learn about them, to evolve, to recognize them in our criteria and terminology. And lastly, I wanted to thank a very special assistant that I have. She's 6 years old, and believe it or not, she loves microscopy, but only if it's insects. So if any of you have any studies involving insects, she's your go-to person. So then thank you for your attention.
Okay. Any questions for Natasha? These are tough tumors. You know, there is a editorial in Journal of Pathology about round cell tumors. Again, we are going through the same type of multiple different rearrangements or translocations, and the question asked is, what's in a name? Is it a phenotype, genotype, function, or patient behavior? Oh, so I guess as pathologists, we have the responsibility to put all of it together. So
you know,
that's great.
There is a good saying that everything new is a repeat of old. You know, this issue of rhabdoid tumors and what they are, where they come from, are they, you know, just a phenotype? Are they a distinct entity? I mean, that's an age-old problem. And I think we're just replaying it here, but it's really wonderful that we have these new techniques to address this question. But I think we're sort of coming back to an age-old question.
Depends on where they come from, which organ system. It must make a difference. Yeah.